So let us start again. We are studying theory of rings, and last time when I was solving a problem, there was another small mistake, so I want to complete that and then go to the next topic. Okay, so what was the problem? The problem was on number 32, on 250, whatever, that 6 or 7. Okay, 257. Okay, the problem was that if I is the ideal generated by 2 plus 2i, and in the ring which is Zx, then we need to examine R by I. I made a small mistake there, because see, when x in R is in I, we know that x maps onto 0 in R by I, because we are taking the quotient by I. So the elements in I will be mapped onto 0 in the quotient or in the factor ring. That is fine. So 2 plus 2i is in the I ideal. So 2 plus 2i will be congruent to 0 mod I, which means that 2i is congruent to minus 2. So we get 4i square is equal to 4. So far so good. But we also know that I square is equal to minus 1. So last time I used the equality in the wrong way, and so what do I get? I actually get that 4i square is equal to 4 equal to minus 4 in the quotient. So what do we get? We get 8 is congruent to 0 mod I. So 8 is in I, therefore 8 is going to be 0. But that is not all. What are the elements in I? Think again. They are R times 2 plus 2i, where little r is in R, any element of R. And now if you examine, what you realize is that 2 times 1 plus I into 1 minus I, and what will that be? That will be 1 minus I square, and the imaginary part will vanish, and what you get is 4. So this 4 is in I, and therefore 4 is going to be 0 in the quotient R by I. So not only 8, but even 4 is 0. So what are the elements of R by I now? They are 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 is 0, then I, 1 plus I, 2 plus I, and 3 plus I, because 4 is 0. And 2i will be equal to minus 2, that also we know. So these are the 8 elements. Now I want you to check that none of this except 0, none of these except 0 is in I. So these are all the 8 elements in the quotient, and an integral domain or a field of 8 elements does exist. Even then, this is not an integral domain. Why? It is easy to see that 2 multiplied by 2 is 0, and 2 is not equal to 0. Therefore, R by I is not an integral domain, therefore not a field, and the ideal is neither prime nor maximal. And we are also asked to find the characteristic of this factor ring or quotient ring. So what is the characteristic? What is the definition of characteristic? A characteristic of a ring is the smallest positive integer which annihilates every element in the ring. Now 4 into 1 is equal to 0, and no smaller integer will multiplied by 1 will give you 0, because 1 into 2 is 2, 1 into 3 is 3. Therefore, the characteristic of the factor ring is 4. We have already seen that if 4 annihilates 1, the unity in the ring, then 4 happens to be the characteristic of the ring. Okay? So, we are using all the things that we learnt. Now, having completed this problem, I want to leave the rest of the problems for you to try, and they are not very difficult from that chapter. And I want to move to the next idea, that is the homomorphism between rings. Okay, you have studied group theory, and you also know what homomorphism of groups is. Let me just remind you, what is homomorphism between two groups? It is a map. Let us just refresh our memory. If G1 is a group, binary operation given by circle, and G2 is another group, binary operation given by star, say, then a homomorphism from G1 into G2 is a map H which satisfies the following properties: H of A1, A2 is going to be H of A1 star H of A2. So, how is that expressed? This means that the mapping H is compatible with the group operations, or it respects the group operations which are binary operations in G1 and G2. So, that is the condition on the map, so that the map becomes a homomorphism. And you know quite a few theorems regarding homomorphisms between groups. Now, we are going to study homomorphism between rings. But you know that ring has two binary operations. If R is a ring with two binary operations and S is another ring with other two binary operations, for a minute I am going to denote the operations with slightly different symbols so that it is clear to you which operation I am using. Okay? And then you need a mapping H from R to S. Just as the mapping in groups had to satisfy this relation, now we need to have another. H of A1 plus or minus, you could have written, is equal to H of A1, this is an addition in the image ring S, that is why I am using different notation. And the other binary operation is also compatible with the mapping, or the mapping respects that. Then H is a homomorphism from R to S. Again, just like groups, a homomorphism, a special homomorphism, becomes isomorphism. And when is that? When a homomorphism H from R to S is 1-1 and onto H is said to be a homomorphism. To be an isomorphism. So there again it is very similar to similar ideas in group theory. As I always tell my students, whenever you come across a new idea, a new definition, even a stunning theorem, please look at lot of examples, because that is the best way to learn and memorize the statements and the definitions, and that helps you to solve the problems. So let us look at some examples of homomorphisms. The most familiar ring is Z. So let us take the homomorphism from Z to Zn. And what are Zn? N is integer m, here is mapped onto another integer m, but you read it mod n. So any integer is now read mod n, and therefore that is the mapping into Zn. You can check that this is a homomorphism. You can check that the addition and multiplication are preserved. Another example. Now we are considering the ring of complex numbers. Don't worry, we are not going to do too much of analysis here, but C is also a ring, usual addition and multiplication. Now what is the mapping? H takes complex number Z into Z bar, or A plus IB into A minus IB. That is the complex conjugate. You can check that this is also a homomorphism. Just make sure that the additions are mapped onto additions here and also multiplications. So these are some simple examples. There are some more. In fact, Galien gives quite a few. The third one that he is mentioning, yes. Consider the space of polynomials now. My ring is the space of all polynomials in X, coefficients real number. Then what is the mapping? The mapping is Fx, any function, any polynomial is mapped onto the value of f at 0. Oh, you can take it any point, in fact. He wants f1, so we will have f1, but f1 or f0 doesn't really matter. You can take the value of the polynomial at any point. That is a mapping. And that preserves addition and multiplication, and so it is a homomorphism. Okay, let us just see what is the range ring. Here this is the domain ring and this is the range ring. Okay, now what will be here? Range ring is Zn, domain is Z. Here domain and range both are C. Here the domain is the ring of polynomials, and what is the range now? The range is set of real numbers. So here very significantly the domain ring and the range ring are different. So you are going to have lots of examples of this type as well. Let us now look at the interesting example that Galien gives. What is this? Now the mapping is phi, where x goes to 5x. But where is this x? This x is in Z4, and this 5x is in Z20. So just see very carefully. In this ring, addition multiplication is read modulo 4, whereas in this ring the operations are read modulo 20. Let us check whether this is a homomorphism. So if R1 is mapped onto 5R1, but here it is mod 20 and this one is mod 4. okay, and R2 is mapped onto 5R2. First of all, it should be well defined. What do you mean by well defined? If you take two representatives of the same class, they should give you the same image. Okay? So, if R is congruent to S mod 4. So, here R and S both are the representatives of the same class. In that case, what is phi R? Phi R is equal to 20k plus 5s, but this is congruent to 5s mod 20, because in the image we read mod 20. Oh, this is 5 and this is s. I am sorry, it looks rather similar. This is 5 and this is s. I hope it is not confusing anymore. And what about 5s directly? That is just 5s. So, it is, phi is well defined. For different representatives of the class, we get the same value of phi. Next, we also want to see if phi preserves addition and multiplication, or it is compatible with multiplication and addition. Let us check the addition R1 and R2. What is phi of R1 plus phi of R2? This is 5R1 plus 5R2 modulo 20 though, and 5 of R1 plus R2, what would that be? 5 times R1 plus R2, which is again the same, 5R1 plus 5R2. That seemed rather easy. But what about multiplication? Now, phi of R1 into phi of R2, what would that be? That is 5R1 into 5R2 mod 20. And what is phi of R1, R2? That is 5R1, R2. But this is 25R1, R2. So, they look like different numbers, but on the right hand side, which is in Z20, we know that 25 is congruent to 5 mod 20. Therefore, phi of R1 into phi of R2 is the same as phi of R1, R2. So, phi preserves addition and multiplication, and therefore phi is a homomorphism between the rings Z4 and Z20. Later on we will see examples where a similar multiplication does not give a homomorphism. Again, just as in groups, homomorphism may not be isomorphism, and in that case you can get more integers mapping into the same image. A very very standard example is the first one that we saw, Z to Zn, because here the range has got only n elements, whereas the domain is infinite, and you can see that quite a few elements, infinite elements, are mapped onto one element here, on each element here in fact. So, this thing is quite common. Okay, now the next is we have to determine all homomorphisms from Z12 into Z30. We have to be careful now. You already know group homomorphisms. You also are aware of group theory, elementary one, I am not going to use very complicated things, but what is the order of this group? It is 12. And what is the order of this one? It is 30. What is the order of an element in a group? That is the least positive integer. Which power of that element gives you identity? Like the least positive integer, such that if multiplication is the group operation, then a raised to n must be equal to e. That will be the smallest positive integer such that this happens. And for a finite group, you know that every element has got a finite order, and not only that, but the order of the element divides the order of the group. This also you are aware of. Now, consider Z12 as an additive group. Z12 is abelian group under addition. And our homomorphism is going to preserve addition. So, the image of Z12 will also be a group in Z30. I am speaking only of addition just now. So, we have to consider homomorphism H which will satisfy this. So, for any, now again, if phi a homomorphism, first remember this, homomorphism is completely determined because this is a commutative ring with unity. It is a completely determined by phi of 1, because 1 generates the whole additive group here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 up to 11, and 12 is 0. So, if we want to find a homomorphism phi, this is completely determined by phi 1. And what is the order of 1 here? The order of 1 here is 12. And let us say that it is equal to A. Now, order of A has to be a factor of 12 and 30 both. Of 12 as well as 30. Why? Because phi A is in Z30, it generates a group, additive group in Z30. So, the order of phi A will have to divide 30, order of phi 1. And because 1, 12 times 1 is 0 here, so the order of 1 is 0 here, so the order of phi 1 will also be a divisor of 12. See, I wrote this in the multiplicative group, but for a additive group, it will be this relation. Since normally you write the group operation in multiplication, I wrote the rule in this way, but here we are considering the abelian additive group. So, this is the relation that I am considering here. The order of 1 is 12 here. The order of 1 is 30 here. 30 times 1 is 0 in the range, and 12 times 1 is 0 in the domain. And the order of phi 1, that is A, is to be a factor of 12 as well as 30. Now, go to the next step. So, what are the elements, or what are the integers which satisfy this condition? Common factors of 12 and 30. So, order of A, additive order mind you, is going to be 2, 3 or 6. or 1, of course. Order of 1 is means 0. Order of A is equal to 1 implies A is equal to 0. The identity itself. Remember again, this is the additive group. Don't get confused with the multiplicative notation. This is the additive group that we are taking. So, and if order is 2, then what do you have? Then A will be 15. 15 is the only element with order 2. If order is 3, what do you have? Now, which are the integers which have order 3 in Z30? 10 and 20. Okay? Because 10 into 3 is 30, that is 0. 20 into 3 is 60, that is also 0. And order won't be less than 3 for both of them. And order of 6, order of A is 6. So, what are the possibilities? 6. So, 5 is 1. And 25 is 1. So, these are all the possibilities for the image of 1 under 5. And we will have so many homomorphisms. But there is another restriction. Like when we examined the mapping from Z4 to Z20 and we saw the multiplication by 5, we needed to verify one more thing there. Because 25 was congruent to 5 mod 20, so that particular mapping was a homomorphism. Similarly, because this 1 into 1 is, okay, now consider the multiplication in the ring. Okay, so far we considered only the addition, but in Z12, 1 into 1 is equal to 1. So translate this in Z3 under 5, what does it mean? 51 into 51 is equal to 51, because 5 is compatible also with multiplication. Now, is this condition also satisfied here? Here, yes, because 15 square is 225. And that is 15 mod 30 again. 10 square is 100 and 100 is 10. But what about 20? Now 20 square is 400 and that is not. What happened? 20 square is 400. And modulo 30, this is only 10. Mod 30, so this is out. 20 square is not congruent to 20. 5 square is 25. Is it congruent to 5 again mod 30? No, because 5 square is 25 and that is congruent to minus 5. So this will be out. 25 square. Now what is 25 square? 25 square is 625. Yes, this is congruent to 25 mod 30. So, this will do. So, these are the candidates for the image of 1. And since they will help us preserve not only addition, but they will also preserve the multiplication under the mapping. So, these are going to be the homomorphism. So, in this example, the homomorphisms are given by 5-1 and the possibilities are 5-1 is equal to 0, that is the trivial one. Then there is 15, then 10 and 25. These are the possibilities. Okay? So, as I said, because ring has two binary operations instead of one, We have more things to check, but we also have more rich results, more results. So let us now go to the next example. Okay. A to A square, but it is a characteristic too. Fine. R is a ring with characteristic 2. Then the mapping H, which takes A to A square, we have to check that this is a homomorphism. So let us do that. H of A plus B is equal to A plus B ka square. R is, I think, a commutative ring. That should be so, so that we can write down the, yes, R is a commutative ring of characteristic 2. So we can write our expansion A square plus 2AB plus B square. But characteristic 2 implies 2AB is equal to 0. So A square plus B square. So that is phi of A plus phi of B. And what about the multiplication? Multiplication doesn't pose any problem. HA equal to A square, HB is equal to B square, and H of AB is equal to AB square. And because the ring is commutative, this is A square B square. That is HA into HB. So, making use of the fact that the ring has characteristic 2, so 2 times any element is going to be 0, and both the binary operations are compatible with the map. So, the map happens to be a homomorphism. Okay, the next example is also interesting. What are we supposed to do? Consider 2z. Okay, 2z is a ring, commutative ring. It is, and is it of even integers under addition group iso to z? Is it isomorphic with z? No, of course not. Why? Because there is unity in z. And 2z has no unity. Because if it is isomorphic, then this relation works two ways. There is a mapping from 2z to z which has got an inverse. If it is a additive inverse, and not isomorphic, ring isomorphism, so what is given? If you are given H 2z to z, and it is a group isomorphism, that is under addition, of course, is not possible because this has got a multiplicative identity and this doesn't. Is the ring isomorphic? Yeah. If there exists a group isomorphism, the isomorphism will be then 2 to 1. So that it will be well defined, and under, when you consider it as a ring, it is not ring isomorphism, because there is no identity in one ring. Okay, now the next parts are rather simple, but let us go through them. See, the divisibility by 3 and 9 you have studied when you were in the primary school. Okay, now what I suggest is the following. Galien gives the explanation for divisibility by 9. It's easy enough. I want you to work out on the same lines, divisibility by 3. Exactly on the same lines, there is no difference. Let us go through the divisibility by 9. What is the rule now? If an integer is a n minus 1, hold on, this is what I am writing, a1 and a0. What does it mean? This is in the units place, this is in the tens place, etc. This is in the place of 10 raised to n minus 1 and this is 10 raised to n. So how do you write this? In the expanded form, remember the word expanded again from your primary school. Plus a n 10 raised to n. You normally don't go to more than 3 or 4 digits. So n is usually 2, 3 or 4, but you can go up to n. No problem. Then call this big number capital N. Okay. Then n is divisible by 9 if and only if this is a very large number. Instead of that, if you just take the digits and take their addition, and if you try to see whether that is divisible by 9, then the original number is divisible by 9. That is the rule. Again, if this is a big number, write it in the decimal form, then again take the digits and go on doing it until you get a very small manageable number. But how do you prove that? Easy. This is just the modular mathematics, modular arithmetic in fact. So the actual number is a0 plus a1 into 10 plus a2 into 10 square, so on an into 10 raised to n. And this modular relation is compatible with addition that you already know. And you know that 10 times a1 is congruent to a1 mod 9. 10 raised to 2 times a2 is congruent to a2 mod 9, etc. So you use that, and when you divide by 9, you can have the remainder, not necessarily less than 9, but a correct remainder anyway, even if it is big. So my n is congruent to a0 plus a1, because this is congruent to a1, this is congruent to a2 mod 9. Because each summand is congruent to the digit. So that is the rule. Now I say you work it out for divisibility by 3. It is exactly the same rule. And as an exercise, you can also find out the rule for divisibility by 7, 11 and try to prove them. Okay, another example. He is mentioning, we have already seen this before, but with a different proof now. Consider primes 3, 7, 11 and not only 11, but all the integers congruent to 3 modulo 4. These are all expressed as 4k plus 3 for some positive integer k. Now, can this be expressed as sum of two integers? That is the question. So, if such a relation exists, if there exists a and b in integers with 4k plus 3 is equal to a square plus b square, then read this equation modulo 4. Then what will you get? This will be 0. This will remain 3. And a and b, what happens to them? If a or b is even, then what will you have? A square or B square or both are congruent to 0 mod 4. Because if A is even, it is divisible by 2 and A square is divisible by 4. Similarly for B. So, and if both are odd, in fact for either of them, if A is odd, then how do you write A? A can be written as 2m plus 1. Then what will be A square? Then A square is 4m square plus 4m plus 1, which is congruent to 1 mod 4. So, each of A square and B square is congruent to 0 or 1 mod 4. A square and B square is congruent to 0 or 1 mod 4. But then in any case, what are the possibilities for the sum? The sum will never be 3. In any case, A square plus B square is not congruent to 3 mod 4. Whatever happens to A and B, whether they are even or odd, the sum will be either 0, 1 or 2. See, if both are 0, the sum is 0. If 1 is 0 and 1 is 1, the sum is 1. If both are 1, then the sum is 2. But the sum cannot be 3. So what is the result that we got? Very quickly, very simple method, is that if an integer, positive integer, is congruent to 3 mod 4, it cannot be sum of two integers. This is one of the well-known results in number theory. Okay, now let us write down the properties of ring homomorphisms. They are all rather simple, but you need to read them and remember them, because you will be using these properties when you solve problems. Let me just enumerate the properties, and I will indicate the proofs of those which are rather difficult. They are mostly simple, really. Let us now write down one by one. One, for any R in R, okay, this phi is a homomorphism from ring R to ring S. Right. And A is a subring of R. And B an ideal of S. Now, B is not just a subring, but B is ideal in S. See, in the domain space you got a subring, and in range ring you got an ideal. Now let us look at the rules. One, for any R, little r in R, and positive integer n, what do we have? Phi of nr is equal to n times phi r. And phi of r raised to n, r power n, r multiplied nrs, is equal to phi of r, now this bracket, what bracket shall I use, okay, raised to n. Well, the first rule is quite easy, it follows straight away from the definition of phi. Because this is r plus r n times, this is phi r plus phi r plus phi r n times, and this is the product n time. Take n times r and take their products. Okay, what is, for phi a, this is only notation really. What is the image of the set? Image of phi a, little a, for every little a in capital A. The image of the whole set. It does not have to be a subring. In fact, it can be any subset for this particular rule. Now, if I is an ideal, not just a ring, but I is an ideal in R, of course, and phi is onto S, what does it mean? Every element in capital S is in the image of R. Every element is phi of little r for some r is onto S, then phi A is an ideal. Now, where will that ideal be? It will be in S. Okay, I will write down the next few rules here and then we will verify on either side. Number 4, phi inverse B. What is that? Phi inverse of this whole set B is phi inverse little b for that r in R such that r is equal to phi inverse b for some little b or phi r for b in b, or same thing, phi of little r is in b. We better know both the ways of expressing the same. That is the inverse image. Just see this, that b in the property 4, b doesn't have to come under the image. There may be some elements in capital B which are not in the image of A. Okay? So, you consider only those B's which are in the image and then take the inverse image. Okay. If R is commutative, then so is phi of R. But remember, that doesn't mean that the whole of S is commutative, because it is only the image of R which is commutative. That's what this rule says. Number 6, if R has a unity, and S is not 0, so the homomorphism is not a trivial homomorphism. If the image is a 0 ring, then the homomorphism is a trivial homomorphism. Then phi of 1 and phi is on 2 as well. Not otherwise, remember this, this is very important. Then phi of 1 is the unity in S. 7, if phi is an isomorphism, okay. Oh, that's very trivial. phi is an isomorphism if and only if, okay, but I will write it anyway because it is important. If and only if phi is onto, and the relation that the fact that phi is 1, 1 is expressed in a slightly different way, and kernel of phi, which is all those r with phi r equal to 0, is equal to the 0 set. Only one property I haven't got on the board, and I don't have to write. That means if phi is an isomorphism, phi inverse is a homomorphism, and that is also an isomorphism. Because if phi is an isomorphism, you immediately get the inverse map defined because it is 1 1 onto, and that will also preserve the relations or the binary operations. So let us verify all of these properties. The first one comes from the definition. The second one is almost describing what your phi A is. Third one we will check. Okay? We will check. It is not difficult at all, but we will check. We want to show that phi A is an ideal. We want to show that phi A is an ideal. So, what do we take? B1 and B2 in phi A, remember, not anywhere else in S. You have to take them in the image of A. Then what do you have? Phi of A1 will be equal to B1 and phi of A2 will be equal to B2 for some A1 and A2 in A. That is the definition of phi A. Then because phi, okay, this is equal to phi of A1 plus phi of A2. So, what do you have? This is B1 plus B2 is equal to phi of A1 plus A2, and because capital A is an ideal, this is also in the ideal. In fact, you could also write it like this, plus and minus both. Therefore, you have A1 plus or minus A2 is in phi A. So, phi A is a subring. We still have to check that it is an ideal. For that, we have to show that it is closed under multiplication by elements in B, in phi A in fact. We have to show that it is closed under elements of the image. Let me check what the statement is. Have I written it right? Phi A is an ideal, but it doesn't have to be an ideal in S. It is an ideal in phi R. See, there is a little confusion here. I wrote in S, Galien doesn't write anything, and it is not an ideal in S, because if I take a general element in S, then the multiplication will not be satisfying the law. Where would this be? It is an ideal in phi of R. Add this. So what do you do? Take another S in any element S in phi R. Then S is equal to phi of little r for some r, and then verify. Because A is an ideal, A is closed under multiplication by R, and therefore phi A is closed under multiplication by little s. See? A is an ideal in R. Oh yes, but it is onto. I'm sorry. I didn't see that. So, it is S. I am sorry, because phi r is S. Yes, phi r is S. So, it is an ideal in S. I am sorry. Let's correct. Because any little s is in phi r. So, you can check that it is closed under multiplication. Yes, so that onto, just as here phi is onto is necessary, here also phi is onto is necessary. Otherwise, the ring here will be taken as phi r and not as s. I hope you see the point. Okay, now let us verify the remaining. This again is just the definition. To consider phi inverse B, you collect those elements which are in the image of R and then take the inverse images in R. That is the definition. If R is commutative, then so is phi R. That is also easy because phi is compatible with the multiplication. For 5, it comes from the definition that phi of R1 R2 is phi of R2 R1. Why? Because R is commutative. Therefore, phi R1 phi R2 is equal to phi R2 phi R1. So, if R has unity and phi is onto, then phi 1 is the unity. That again is not difficult to check. Why? Because phi 1 satisfies because R is equal to R into 1. Therefore, phi r is also equal to phi r into phi 1. Therefore, phi 1 commutes, therefore, phi 1 acts as unity for what? For the image of r, but it is onto. Therefore, it acts as unity for the whole of S. I am going to ask you to find an example where phi is not onto and the unity of R is not mapped onto the unity of S. Okay? It's going to be rather tricky, but try to do that. I will tackle this easy thing afterwards and we will also go ahead with other examples.